Welcome back to my tutorial campaign in Realistic Progression Zero, the campaign mod for the Realism Overhaul suite of Realism mods in Kerbal Space Program. In the last episode, we tested an uprated Trebuchet launch vehicle, and we queued up Labrador 14. In this episode, we're going to go ahead and fly Labrador 14. It is a lunar orbital mission. Also going to, I think, go ahead and finally, and for reals, set up our canonical Trebuchet D. I guess Trebuchet C, actually. It's close enough. Trebuchet CV. So let's do that right now. We were calling that the actual C. So we'll call this CV. We need to get rid of all this. And then do this, I think. Just so we stop having the stupidity of procedural fairings and procedural parts misinteracting. We also, I think, want to raise this mass up. That's about right. There. Alright, now we'll merge in. Labrador Labrador block 3, because that has the launch vehicle under us. This needs to get a little wider. There we are. Okay. So, now we go ahead and proceed to upgrade those engines. 16 times 4 is 64, so we have capabilities for a 64-ton stage. What is the mass above it? Why do we have a 2-meter guidance unit there? That's silly. Whoops. Oh, that was the wrong thing to click. Let's fix this. 3-meter guidance unit. That's more correct. Let's find it. It's down here. Go all the way up. The stuff that should be above it. Here is the stuff that should be below it. Move it way up. Okay, and then this comes back down again to there. Okay, now let's look at the stage. We want to extend this stage out to 7 minutes and 50 seconds. That's odd. Procedural parts bugged out, apparently. MechJeb decided to have an issue. Okay, I guess we'll have to redo this. Okay, so step one, get rid of the launch vehicle, get rid of this, and we can't rename it because we don't actually have a control source. We don't have a root part. Excuse me. That was odd. Now it's behaving as expected. All right, now we need a proc tank. Let's see. This. It's about right. And utilization. So we want plenty of electric charge. And now we want lots and lots of lead ballast. Oops. Okay. So now we can set up what we estimate the payload to be. So put this on. Bring this down, bring the whole shebang up. See if that brings us off the floor or not. Not quite. Very well. Let's go ahead and save this so I don't have to restart it again. Now we want to upgrade all the engines ever. So we're going to upgrade these to Arlton A3-3A. We're going to upgrade our J2s to J2S. Okay, and now we're going to go ahead and lengthen out this stage so that we get the full burn time. Oh, for crying out loud. It did it to me again. Don't know why that starts bugging out. And no, it is not an aircraft carrier, even though it is designated CV. Let's try this again. Okay. That is better. Now we need to stretch this out. We'll do a 6-minute stage here. I kind of don't want to push it more than 6 minutes. Okay. Looks like we can't quite do okay, maybe that's enough. Oops. Interesting that we actually have sufficient upper stages that our liftoff thrust is low. That's very interesting. Our liftoff thrust is under 1.2. That interests me a lot. How much throw are we talking about? 20.356 tons. Now, admittedly, that's with those big old fairing sides. So effectively, we're actually throwing 21 tons. So a little under my 23-ton estimate of last night, but it should be sufficient for our purposes. Now, the real question is, how heavy is this stage? Well, it's... four tons, and so five tons, we're rounding up, and 49 tons, and 52 tons, 53 tons, 50, how many, six, they're fairly light, if memory serves. So we're certainly under 64 tons, which is mostly what I'm concerned about, which is the avionics limit for that stage. We're assuming that the payload itself will handle its own avionics, which is perhaps not the best assumption, but whatever. All-up mass is still under 1,000 tons. So we're throwing just under half what Saturn V could to the moon, and we're under 1,000 tons, less than a third of Saturn V's all-up mass. How do these numbers look? We'll have high gravity losses. We'll certainly have high gravity losses, because this is a long-burning stage. And it will take us probably 9 minutes to get to orbit. No, I'm sorry, that's wrong. It will take us rather more than 9 minutes. So it'll take 2 minutes and 45 seconds, plus 6 minutes. That's just 15 seconds short of 9 minutes. That's 8:45. Then 9:45, 10:45, 11, maybe even 11 and a half minutes to get to orbit. So we're facing large gravity losses. Let us see how much excess liquid hydrogen we're running with. 298.25.9 times 0.7631 over 1 minus 0.7631 is 96,000, and we're at 98.5. So 2,500 spare liters of liquid hydrogen. That may not be enough. I am not sure. I'm sort of depressed that despite this massing 160 tons more, we're not actually getting that much extra capability. But we're getting enough that it's worth it. Why did that do that? Oh, probably because I right-clicked on it. Oh, no, that stayed. But I think we need to move up a little bit. Yeah, that's fine. All right. So this launch vehicle, I think, I'm not certain, but I think, will be our final heavy lift launch vehicle. Super heavy lift. It's not heavy lift, it's super heavy lift. This will be our final super heavy lift launch vehicle. I don't think that we will need anything heavier than this to get to the moon or do other... send probes to anywhere or do anything. I mean, if we look at actually sending humans out to... Mars, or for a Venus flyby, then maybe we'll need more of a launch vehicle, although we might also consider an Earth orbit rendezvous mission profile, where we send up, like, the spacecraft as one launch of this, we send up the ejection stage as a second launch, and we send up the propellant in another couple launches. So, there is one final upgrade that we'll be making before too long, and that is once we unlock the RD-170 class engines, we will replace these 7 NK33s with 2 RD-170s, or 171 actually, because we need two axis gimbal. That will have rather more liftoff thrust than two F1 engines. Right now we have the liftoff thrust of about two F1 engines. Because if you look at the actual performance statistics of this, that would not appreciably change anything. We're looking at 1584.6 kilonewtons of liftoff thrust times 7. That's 11 meganewtons of thrust. Now, an F1 is about 1.5 million pound force of thrust at sea level. And oh goodness, what? Oh right, we can check. Where is it? F1. Sea level is 6696. Now that's not the F1A, which is probably a fairer comparison. So the F1A is 9189.6 times 270 over 310. That's 8. So we have 1 3/8 the liftoff thrust of an F1 engine. An F1A. We have 1.65 times the liftoff thrust of an original F1. So yes, we're sitting well between a Saturn 1B class launch vehicle and a Saturn C3 class launch vehicle. With two F1s, although we actually plan to, we actually are beating the performance of a Saturn C3 due to higher tech, due to luscious Soviet stage combustion technology on the first stage, and probably due to a lower structural fraction at times. All right, so this is all set. I think we probably should do, man, that's expensive, $46 million. But I think it's probably worth queuing it as an all-up test flight, because we of course don't want to be wrong when we launch a capsule. I am scared about this. I don't think we're packing enough liquid hydrogen. So we are at 29,800. Let's extend this out, bring this back to 29,800. Actually, I guess 29,850. And let's add to this. So 29,850 times 0.7631 over 1 minus 0.7631, just calculating how much liquid hydrogen we should have, 96.1 kiloliters. We have 99.6, so that's 3,500 liters. All right, that might be enough, especially because this is not balloon. This is not a balloon tank stage. This is a tank type default stage. We're throwing enough mass that I really don't want to deal with a, like, we're talking about 20 plus tons of payload above it. I don't feel comfortable making this a balloon tank. So yes, we have a common bulkhead second stage with fairly high efficiency, and we of course have a balloon tank stage here with very high efficiency. Right. So, right. That is the thing that I've signally forgotten to do, is fix these things so that they're not sitting out here. That's fixed. Now, we'll grab these two, put them back. All right. So, this launch vehicle is ready. I'm going to go ahead and make it a subassembly. Let's go ahead and... Yeah, I don't feel like cheating today, so I'm not going to simulate it. I'm just going to build it. Those extra RL-10 engines and the larger stages are making it cost another $8 million compared to the previous trebuchet. Alright. So, subassembly time. Let's just verify that our staging is correct. It is correct. That's nice. Okay, and it's 21 tons TLI, 100, 180, 40. Is my guess for what it will require. It does have a larger burn time than the last one, and that one we wanted more like 160. So, seems about right. All right. Now, let's go ahead and fly Labrador 14. Don't have much to do other than warping to it being done. Roll it out. Takes 2 days and 6 hours to roll out. Alright, now let's pick our crew. Let's see who's not been to the moon yet. Dennis Green has not been to the moon yet. Interesting. Okay, so the first two haven't been to the moon yet. She has. Where's a pilot who had? Mike Horton has not been to the moon yet. Debbie Newman has not been to the moon yet. Alright. So, we'll go with these two, and it comes down to, I guess, either Mike Horton or Debbie Newman. So, I don't know, we'll figure it out by the time we actually... launch. So, because this actually has a required orbit, I'm going to go ahead and look at the moon. But the required orbit doesn't show. Because it's not a specific orbit, it's just an inclination limit. So it doesn't actually matter. We are almost looking at a direct we are almost looking at a direct injection to the moon. So we're gonna wait. I think a couple days, at least one day. Let the moon get a little bit closer to its nadir Alright, now we're going to go out to the pad. Save. It's 196. Oops, we're in 1964 now. 0520. No. 420. Oh, it's. No, we're not in May. Well, I'll just rename that save. I don't know why I did that. Okay. So. Let's go. We'll do my Corton. My Corton has not been to the moon yet. We'll leave Dennis Green as mission commander. He's certainly been in the astronaut corps long enough. We're not filling this crew cabin. It's purely so they have extra space to stretch their legs. We'll head out. Takes a long time to load. There we are. There we are. So. I think we have probably an 8-hour wait until we're in the plane of the moon, but let's find out. Set as target. Okay. And we want to. Launch into plane of target. Ha! 8 hours and 44 minutes. Alright, so I was a little off. 180, but we won't pitch up as aggressively. Engage autopilot. Okay. As it comes into the afternoon. Okay, 50, so 3, it's 3 p.m. local time, unless I've done that, unless we're in daylight saving time, in which case it's 4 p.m. I think, no. Oh, no, I've been doing that math wrong all this time. It's minus 5 hours, not minus 6 hours. That makes much more sense. Okay, we're tense. Whoa, that was. We'll be right back. That seems to be a KSP issue of some sort. Physics jerk on setting up the pad. Yeah, we'll be right back. Okay. Well, that was not cool. Oops. Good we saved before we launched. Not even really sure why that was, because we didn't even touch the pad. But, you know, it happens. So I have to remember to, I guess, to turn on hack gravity right before that. KJR is supposed to ease physics during coming off rails, which it was doing, but there's maybe something else. We probably have to. I guess I need claw stock bug fixes that make the pad invulnerable for a second or two when you come off warp. Try this again. Try this again. Okay. Interesting that the first time it is okay, but the fact that we go on Rails warp and then come out of it again is what kills things. So, okay, fine. Whatever. Oh, no, I didn't want to do that. I just want to set its target. Launch into plane of target. Engage autopilot. Now, what I will do is hack gravity just as it comes off rails. Just so it doesn't bounce coming off rails. And yes, I've been wrong with the 6 hour thing. It's actually 5 hours, of course, because GMT is Eastern time is 5 hours difference from GMT. If we're in daylight, it's 4 hours different. Okay, and ready on the button. And hack. Okay. The large shock waves have subsided, and we're good to go. Okay, we have liftoff at 19 minutes past the hour. 90 minutes and 50 seconds. Reset launch azimuth. We are in slowdown time mode because we have a lot of parts in this launch vehicle because we're launching. Our command and service module is like double the number of parts. Oh well. this looks almost like, you know, one of those early Thor Able or Thor Delta rockets where it has that long derpy upper stage pencil rocket, because of just how long this stage and then the fairing of the service module is. We probably would do better to do that as more of a an S4 stage where it's fatter and shorter. It would look a little less silly, but probably be a little more massive, although it would have lower boil off because less surface area for volume. Let's verify that keep throttle limited is checked, limited acceleration is checked. We could probably get away with limiting to 3 Gs, really. No wonder this looks weird. I forgot that this was the half and half rocket. I totally forgot. This is the rocket that has the short... Whoa, we definitely need a much lower turn shape than that. Yeah, I forgot all about that. This is not, in fact, the Trebuchet CV. This is the Slapdash Trebuchet B2RB, or RC, sorry, or Trebuchet CRC. I forget what we're calling it exactly. With this shortened first stage and a very shortened second stage. It's 40 seconds short. And the third stage is only 4 RL-10s, not 6. So, yeah. This is an interesting lash-up, I'll put it that way. So far, it's all going well for a lash-up. It's got those 6 NK-33s. They're doing fine. We're only going to have, like, 2 or 3 seconds worth of down-throttling to keep the Gs at 3.75. Steering losses are nice and low. Gravity losses, of course, are not nice and low. Okay, let's come left. We have 15 seconds to first stage burnout. Five seconds to first stage cutoff. 2 seconds. And now we have 1 second of throttling down. So, burnout, separation and ullage, J2 ignition. That's slow as treacle. Let's pitch up and get rid of the Hort tower, because things are looking good. Okay, unlike last time, our J2s are not floating in space. That's nice. How are we doing on boil off? Not horrible. Only 250 or so liters boiled off so far. Let us examine the map. Look at our orbital plane. Okay, that's parallel. And we are a bit to the south of it, looks like. So let's come north a bit more. So drop our inclination even faster. Looks like we're going to need to pitch up rather more. I think we may not have lofted quite high enough for this. Yeah, we didn't loft high enough. So we'll pitch up even more. Okay, now our apogee is rising a bit better. Okay, now we can start to pitch down a little bit. Alright, and it looks like we need to come right a little bit to match our longitude of the ascending node. Right a little bit more. Okay, now I can pitch down a bit more. Tighten up our inclinational alignment. Okay. Time to apogee is looking pretty decent. We do want to raise apogee a little bit more, stretch out time to apogee, because we do have a long burn ahead of us on the third stage. Looks like we're lining up fairly close. Alright, now that's enough, I think. That's really fairly decent alignment. Didn't even have that much in the way of steering losses. Okay, and burnout. Whoa, that was a serious staging malfunction. What just happened there? Apparently these lit. Well, shoot. Alright, I just staged away my upper stage because I thought that it was like the new model where the RCS lit before those engines, rather than in the same stage. So I saw the RCS lighting, I figured I better stage again to light the engines. That instead, Okay, so... we are going to, I guess, abort to orbit and then re-enter. And that's a waste of a launch. Let's pitch up, because it's going to be a while. We're 600 meters... no, 500 and change meters per second short of orbital velocity. This is such a shame, because... we were aligned so well with the lunar plane, 0.05 degrees. This was purely pilot error. That's really tragic. But it's just as well because we haven't actually launched this spacecraft yet. So we haven't even done a flight test of this. Which reminds me, right, I was going to do a low Earth orbit mission with this thing anyway to shake it out. Make sure it actually works okay. We just used a much larger launch vehicle than intended. I really should not have sent this straight to the moon without a low Earth orbit test with it. Okay, pitch up a bit more. Yes, I'm sorry for those of you who are expecting a lunar orbital mission today. Myself included, by the way. But that is apparently not going to happen. Instead, we'll do this abort to orbit. We are, however, perfectly aligned with the plane of the moon. Not that we can do very much because we don't have that much delta V. I mean, we have gobsmacking large quantities of delta V for a service module, but that's not enough delta V to get to the moon by any stretch of the imagination. All right, 230 meters per second to orbit, looks like. pitching down a little bit. Yes, this was a really quite decent launch, I have to say. I'm sorry that it ended up kind of wasted, but this launch went quite well. A little bit more. Okay, we have achieved circular orbit. Yeah. So that was kind of a waste. Yes, we're now too far out. Okay. So we're gonna go ahead and now build Labrador 15, we're going to build. Right, and we haven't even... Yes, we never actually flight tested that engine even. I've really been putting the cart before the horse regarding sending that thing to the moon. I noticed it doesn't have a test flight configuration, so it's not going to fail, but just for being above board the way we've played this game so far, we really should have sent up an uncrewed version of the whole thing. But failing that, we really should have at least sent up a low Earth orbit test version of it. So let's go ahead and rebuild this with the new launch vehicle with all of its manifold excess capacity. There. Now, I love the fact that we almost have enough delta V to put the escape tower on escape as well. Okay, so let's tighten that up. Tighten this up and make sure that the engines are still in the correct position. They do appear to be, so I think that's fine. Let's get it above ground. Okay, that's high enough that hopefully we won't have any pad contact issues. Okay. This is Labrador 15. This one is going to make it to the moon, we trust. So we'll go ahead and build this. It's quite expensive. It's $68 million. Looks like we build it about $1 million a day. So, build. Let's see. Is this? Yeah, this does not have a test flight config. It's an AJ-10-118F from the Delta F, series of Delta launches, the Delta F stage. That was the penultimate AJ-10 for Delta. The final is the AJ-10-118K, used on Delta 2. So we're going to happily, we will actually fly a test of that launch vehicle before Labrador 15. We will then fly Labrador 15 around the moon to verify that command and service module. Once, while that's going, we'll start building our, how are we doing on tech? Oh good, we've got space exploration. So yes, we can then start building our lander. And then we'll go to the moon. We'll go land on the moon. So, back to the tracking station. So, oh yes, that's right. This is a bug that I fixed in 1.2 that is not fixed right now. So we have to select another thing to go to and then go to Labrador 14. It's interesting that oh right, because yes, there are multiple. There was the second stage and the third stage. So we'll go sit on this stage and then swap to Labrador 14. And it will complete a simple Earth orbital mission. It will exhaust its propellant to increase its entry velocity and then re-enter the Earth. Yes, this poor crew, they were looking forward to, oops, they've been looking forward to going to the moon, but they are not going to go to the moon. That is, I believe, come on. Oh, we did switch to it. Okay. No, we didn't switch to it. That's weird. Oh, it's in the atmosphere. Ugh. So we'll have to pick something else to go to and then switch to Labrador 14. Those of you who have been viewing these videos forever, we'll have to back me up on this, but I believe, though I'm not certain, I believe that Labrador 14 is the first mission-ending failure of a crewed mission we have had this entire campaign. I mean, it's a partial failure. We're doing the backup Earth orbital mission, but it is. We still have not yet had to actually use the escape tower. And Labrador 13, of course, was a fail at lunar injection and again at return, but alright, let's pick one of these things. But I believe that Labrador 14 is the first actual had to do a different mission thing that we've had for a crewed orbital mission. Okay, now let's go find where is it? There it is. Okay, so we're going to, we have full solar, looks like we're aligned with the sun. So yes, we're getting over a kilowatt from each of these solar panels. That's great. Now, let's go ahead and do an orbit. And verify that we have full electric charge. We do. That's great. Now, let's look at the capsule. That all looks sane to me. So we're going to go ahead and set up a retrograde maneuver that's going to bring us down in the Pacific. And I think we want to do that right about here. Actually, no, we want to do it like this. We have 1263 meters per second remaining. So what is that? Ooh, that's a little low. Still a little low. That's more just about right. So we want to do this maneuver right about here. So we'll come down nicely in the, actually a bit further over, I think. Even further than that. Right about there. Okay, so that maneuver is 1 hour 10 minutes. This is 1 hour 16 minutes. Alright, so we will have to be somewhat careful exactly how we burn that maneuver so that we don't end up in the atmosphere during burning it. Come on. Let's warp. Whoa, that's a bit too close to the maneuver. I was carefully doing this non-automatically because I wanted to start before the maneuver, but more than a minute before the maneuver, but apparently that's not going to happen. So there we are. So I'm actually going to burn above so that we don't get too high a sink rate too early. And then fix. Whoa, that's a little bit too high. Alright, come down to about here, I think. Because we do have a long burn ahead of us. Basically doing this to, you know, stress out the heat shield. Although nothing has changed with the heat shield, so it's not that big a deal. So let's, given that we went past the maneuver, let's cut it a little short, burn a little down, just establish that 35 whatever kilometer perigee. Sink rate is almost 100 meters per second. That means 10 seconds a kilometer. There's about 40 kilometers to go. 400 seconds, that's fine. Although we are, of course, increasing our sink rate. Call it 200 seconds all told. That's still going to just be okay, I think. But I think we have to cut it a little shorter than that. we've only gained about 200 meters per sec, 250 meters per second of orbital velocity. 260. I forget what we were before we did this. 7.7 something. So the total burn time of this stage is equivalent to what we used to have. It's only a little shorter. I think what we used to have about an 11-minute service module stage. This has twice the thrust, and the burn time was about the same. So, you know, it's about twice the impulse. But due to how much extra mass there is on this thing because of this, that section, we don't get any extra delta V. Alright, yeah, we definitely want to get that perigee down as quickly as possible. Why is it wavering like that? That's weird. Whatever. Alright, we're nearing the correct perigee. We're also getting dangerously low to the start of the atmosphere. Well, when KSP starts modeling the atmosphere, obviously there's atmosphere even up here, but KSP isn't modeling it. All right. Okay, and let's turn these things on. And jettison. And align with surface retrograde, pitched up a little. Turn descent mode on. We're entering the atmosphere. Somewhere around here is our service module, so it will go boom-a-boom during descent, but we don't care about it, because we are tossing away like 10 million funds on that. Because the service module, of course, unlike before where it was literally just an engine and some solar panels and some propellant, this time it has a whole HAB section and life support supply, you know, a full life support system and all that stuff. So it is a rather more expensive loss than usual, but hey, they're going to the moon. They deserve some creature comforts if they're going to be have like a two-week mission. Now, we did, of course, fly a two-week mission originally with this craft to verify things. That was as close quarters as that Gemini two-week mission was. So hopefully that crew really liked spending time with each other because they were literally within arm's reach of each other for 2 weeks. Accepting any EVAs. And there goes service module. Lots of explosions. Man, that was quite a big explosion. Now, of course, in real life, they would just melt and, like, shred and all that stuff. They wouldn't be exploding. But KSP, gotta have the explosions. Yes, now their ballistic coefficient is low enough that drag is affecting them much more. They have much less inertia, so much less inertia compared to their drag, so we're going past them. And those last remaining bits will blow up eventually. As I said. Now we're getting some serious heating. Okay, there go the last bits, I think. Unless I miss some. So. We are coming into the atmosphere with a rather greater vertical velocity than usual for our re-entry, so our peak G is going to be higher. We're still going to level off about 60 kilometers. We kind of do that no matter what. Going up again. So let's roll inverted, kill off that vertical speed. Yeah, we've got plenty of RCS propellant, so we're good. Okay, now we're sinking again. We cut our skip short. And we're going to flip once we get to 100. Okay, flipping back up. Trying to assist mech jeb sometimes makes it worse, apparently. Okay, so second dip. nearing the level off point. Okay, so we're going to roll 45 degrees to keep our descent rate more than like 16. This will change our inclination slightly, but we don't really care where we land, so. Okay, and back to 40, so let's level out. Now the G's are increasing again. Sync rate's increasing pretty quickly, so we're going to have a fairly high G spike. I think. Okay, we're gonna hit max G before too long. Sync rate's still increasing, past 100 meters per second. But not increasing, well, no, it's still increasing fairly quickly actually, so I don't know. Okay, almost to 2 G's. 2 G's. Alright, now the sync rate is increasing much more slowly. Now it's decreasing. Okay, so we should be hitting max G quite soon.